ಉಳ್ಳವರು ಶಿವಾಲಯ ಮಾಡಿಯರು, ನಾನೇನು ಮಾಡುವೆ ಬಡವನಯ್ಯ, ಎನ್ನೆ ಕಾಲೇ ಕಂಬ ದೇಹವೇ ದೇಗುಲ, ಶಿರವನ್ನ ಕಲಿಸುವಯ್ಯ ಕೂಡಲ ಸಂಗಮ ದೇವ, ಕೇಳಯ್ಯ ಸ್ಥಾವರ ಕಳಿ ಉಂಟು ಜಂಗಮ ಕಳಿವಿಲ್ಲ. ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್ ಈವ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್. ರವೀಂದ್ರ ಕೋರೆಯರ್, ಚೇರ್ಮನ್ ಆಫ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗೂರ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಚ್, ಫುಲ್ಹಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ಲಿ ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಯು ಫಾರ್ ದಿ 73rd ಜ್ಞಾನ ದಾಸೋಹ ಲೈವ್ ವೆಬ್ಕಾಸ್ಟ್ ಸೆಷನ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೂರ್ ಬ್ರಾಂಚ್. ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್, ಟುಡೇ ಅನ್ಫಾರ್ಚುನೇಟ್ಲಿ ವಿ ನೋ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಡ್ಯೂ ಟು ಅನ್ಅವೈಡಬಲ್ ಸರ್ಕಮ್ಟನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಯು ನೋ ದಿಸ್ ಪ್ಯಾಂಡಮಿಕ್ ಸಿಚುವೇಶನ್, ಟುಡೇಜ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಸ್ಪೀಕರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಚೇಂಜ್. ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ವಾಸ್ ಅನೌನ್ಸ್ ನ್ಯೂ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಷನಲ್ ಅಪಾರ್ಚುನಿಟೀಸ್ ಬೆನಿಫಿಟ್ಸ್ ಅವೈಲಬಲ್ ಅಂಡರ್ ಫಾರಿನ್ ಟ್ರೇಡ್ ಪಾಲಿಸಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಸ್ಕೀಮ್ಸ್. The speaker was from C. Abhishek Sharma, Jaipur. He couldn't able to join. We can understand the situation and he is not able to deliver the lecture today. And also, even if you postpone also, he has to take at least 15 days rest. So with that, immediately we caught up and helping hand. Very, very short notice. It is, I can say it is less than 3 hours. The person get ready. And yes, I told the commitment is professional opportunities for the members. Yes, he will serve for the professional opportunities. It is not in foreign trade. It will be on PEMA. So the today's speaker, none other than CA Santosh Kumar from with us. On behalf of all the viewers and the managing committee members of Bangalore branch, I wholeheartedly welcome CA Santosh for the today's session. And taking, because we have scheduled the session, and made everything arrangement yesterday, we sent a link. Unfortunately, it is, you know, that it is today's speaker is not able to do the session. So immediately we contacted Santosh. He is ready to members. Kindly make note that when before lockdown, Santosh was the last batsman. Now he is today is serving as a night watchman. He can test because the day last physical session was taken by Santosh. And till that 72nd sessions, he has served as night watchman only, back end. Today is ready to do the session. And that was the commitment. The Bangalore branch members always show the commitment whenever need for the branch. Because it is an easy task. We can postpone it or cancel it. But again, Abhishek Sharma session, maybe we can plan it in November or November maybe. But what I committed is, Bangalore branch is committed is, we wanted to have a professional opportunities, at least a new areas trend for the benefit of the members. So today we can learn from Santosh on the PEMA, what are the professional opportunities and external borrowings, etc. He will going to address all our members. Kindly make note that I, on behalf of Bangalore branch, my I'm praying for the speedy recovery of CA Abhishek Sharma, who is supposed to take the today's sessions. Hope you will take sessions in upcoming November. You just transfer your foreign trade policy. Before that, we have to learn the what are the authorities in FEMA. The Santosh is taking, Santosh is agreed to take the session. Namage santoshana aitu, mahana aanandavaitu. Yakandre Santosh avaru yavaglu nagta irthare, aa santosha nimagu ellanu ಆಗಿ ನವರಾತ್ರಿ ದಿನದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಹಾಲಕ್ಷ್ಮಿ ಅವರು ಇಲ್ಲೇ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ನಾಟ್ ಟೇಕ್ ಮಚ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಡಿಯರ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್. ಟುಮಾರೋ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಸೆಷನ್ ಆನ್ ಹೌ ಟು ಗ್ರೋ ಯುವರ್ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಡಿಜಿಟಲಿ ಯೂಸಿಂಗ್ ಸೋಷಿಯಲ್ ಮೀಡಿಯಾ ಬೈ ಸಿ ಎ ಸಂಜೀವ್ ಸಾಂಗ್ವಿ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಕೋಲ್ಕತ್ತಾ ಇಸ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್ ದ ಸೆಷನ್. ವಿತ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಐ ಹೋಲ್ ಹಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ಲಿ ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಆಲ್ ಅವರ್ ವಿವರ್ಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಿ ಟುಡೇಸ್ ಸೆಷನ್, ದ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಷನಲ್ ಅಪಾರ್ಟೀಸ್ ಅಂಡರ್ ಹೆಮಾ. I welcome today's speaker Santosh Kumar and all the viewers. Now I request Bangalore branch treasurer CA Divya to formally introduce the speaker to the gathering. Over to Divya.
Thank you, Chairman. First of all, great thanks to Santosh Kumar sir for accepting our invitation such a short notice. Thanks sir also once again wholeheartedly. Just to give brief introduction about our today's speaker CA Santosh Kumar. By qualification, he is chartered accountant with DISA qualification and also company secretary. He has worked for more than 16 years and currently he is holding position as technical head consulting in the functional areas such as financial advisory services, process consulting, internal controls review, business analysis, project reports, forensic consulting, internal audits. He has vast experience in internal controls and process audits and in ERP environments. He previously worked as treasury consultant in Bearing Point Inc. of USA. He has also handled various management consultancy assignments such as merger operation for SMEs, business valuation, project reports and due diligence. Apart from functional knowledge in areas mentioned above, he is also specialized in FEMA, FCRA, internal controls and also process audits. And he has credit of bringing various brands from abroad, providing end-to-end solution and the foreign investments into India by way of equity and ECBIS. With this very brief introduction, I welcome you for today's webinar, sir. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kore, and thank you, Divya, for this introduction. And I must thank Kore and Divya and other team members of Bangalore branch who thought that I will be fit to fill in this gap of by Abhishek Sharma. Koreji for being so humble in his explanation. So I hope that I will do justice to the night watchman job of cricket. So as you know, it is not a full-fledged person, but still this is the area of passion for me. So I believe that I can do some amount of justice to what faith has been reposed by Bangalore branch on me. I think since it's a short notice, I could do a very simple and easy PPT, which is just to indicate that what I'm going to explain, just to have a brief liners on professional opportunities and things like that. Am I audible completely, Koreji?
Audible and visible.
Okay. Thank you. Everyone, FEMA, as you know, that it's a Foreign Exchange Management Act, and it's an area of 49 sections and too many regulations, so many circulars, so many notifications and things like that. So it's always when any particular law has too many notifications, circulars, master circulars outside the purview of Act, it becomes very dynamic for us to keep us updated on the FEMA so that we can do a proper justice to the clients when we are doing our consulting or other works. So it becomes very interesting for us to understand where and all we can create an opportunity. As you know, that FEMA has been there from last 20 years. Okay, it's all about creating an opportunity or identifying an opportunities with this Act. So when I started pursuing this area during 2009 or 2010, I came to understand that this has a very simple sections, but we have a lot of circulars and regulations. So we have to keep us updated on these areas. So just to simplify myself, I identified there are four important areas which we can do, or which the majorly our clients expect us to have an expertise in this area or have an insight in these areas. These are all the areas which generally our clients, maybe small, medium enterprises, generally look our advisors in these four areas. As you know, in the FEMA, out of 49 sections, the major, we have capital account transaction and current account transaction. And this is predominantly is divided into these four areas. First is, the current account transaction is nothing but the trade related matters like exports and imports. Generally, we call it as a trade related matters. And current account transaction involves other activities which are relating to residents and non-residents, transfer of funds, and many other activities are there. But we will restrict ourselves to export and imports. And on the capital account transaction, we have three categories which we generally come into place. One is foreign direct investments. As you know, predominantly it is mentioned as FDIs, which is a very hot word. Every time Modi ji also talks about FDIs. So second one is external commercial borrowings. It is very, very interesting area. This is a very, I have a lot of passion in this area, external commercial borrowings, because we can get very, very cheap funds into India as a loan. As you know, when we leverage the investment, the debt component is a very important component when we leverage the return, rate of return. When we arrive at rate of return, when we borrow funds at a lower rate, we will have a higher leverage in this area. So I think that is very interesting for me. That's a very important area from my point of view. Third one is from a capital account transaction is overseas direct investments, which we call it as ODIs. So ODIs is nothing but we generally, when we do an investment outside India, when we send money outside India on account of capital account transaction, this ODIs will be applicable. So these are all the four broad areas which we generally find opportunities. Now, what type of opportunities we can identify in each of these areas? Let us look into the FDIs. Now, when does the FDI come into place? When any investor who is sitting outside India wants to invest in India in a resident company. Okay. So if there is a transaction between a non-resident who is an investor and a resident in India who is an investee, and an investor wants to invest in Indian company or a resident company, that time the foreign direct investment is applicable. Now, what is that role that we can play in this area? First is as a consulting. I'll just go to the next slide, which are all the type of activities which we do and how we can relate back to the second slide. One is consulting and transaction advisory services. As you know, FDI is a very, there are bulk transactions happen very small companies. I think 70% of the number of transactions of FDIs happens in a smaller SME segment, where big fours or bigger firms may not afford, they may not be able to reach them in every small companies. So we have a large role to play here. We are connected to our SMEs. We have a lot of clients who are having a lot of requirement of getting an FDIs. They are eligible to get the FDIs into the companies. So in that sense, we are connected to smaller SMEs who can take FDIs into their companies, who can take foreign investment into their companies. So as a chartered accountant firm, we can do end-to-end consulting or transaction advisory services for SMEs. As you know, currently there's a huge gap in the funding required and the funds available for expansion in India. Whether you take it capital account transactions, whether you want to expand your businesses, whether you want to invest in plant and machinery, you need more funds. So the banks may not be able to fund everything. So that is why many of the companies who are having a futuristic value, who have technology, who have good projects where investors would like to invest in India, definitely this is a very important area where you can do consulting transaction advisory services. In this also, which are all the key elements which we will have to guide the clients? First one is, what could be the structure of your transaction? What could be the structure of the transaction? What is the management that willing to forgo for the amount which they are going to get into the business? And what is the reasonable amount which they should take it as a capital so that there is no overburden onto the servicing part of it? These are all the important elements. And also, what are the agreements, what are the documentation that you have to do so that you ensure that the client's interests are protected when we are doing this advisory service? This is a very important area and where a lot of shareholders agreement will get prepared. As you know, when we do an FDI, before all other thing, due diligence will happen. Next, after due diligence, we will have the valuation will be done by consulting from our side, from consultant from the other side. After that, we will sign a term sheet. After signing term sheet, we will get into, before that, we will identify the structure. After identifying the structure, we will go into the documentation part. So apart from your structuring advisors, which you do, you will have to do a documentation also, because the documentation will help your SME or the company to ensure that they are committed to what they agreed with the investor, and also the investors have agreed or committed to what they have agreed as part of the shareholders agreement. So this is one of the interesting area, which is every chartered accountant can play a larger role in this. As you know, there will be a right of refusal will be there. There are so many important elements will be there when we are doing this transaction advisory services. And much of the money when we do an FDI is going to be given for this particular activity. as you know. This is the important element. This, when you're doing a documentation also, you have to keep company law and Companies Act into consideration. You have to keep the Income Tax Act for the purpose of pricing, for the purpose of valuation, for the purpose of arriving at share. Securities premium is concerned. You should keep in valuation rules, valuation law which is in place. And also, very importantly, we should keep the FEMA Act, FEMA law in place. FEMA Act also we should complete. So keeping those acts in, keeping those provisions, we need to prepare the shareholders agreement, things like that. Second important point is on the vetting of documents or agreements. So some of the cases, what happens is the client may feel that a shareholders agreement is already prepared by the draft is prepared by the consultant or the investee consultant. So generally what happens is the investees will be generally deriving all the agreements. They are preparing all the agreements. So we may not be able to agree. We may not be able to get that role to play sometimes. So in those circumstances, what happens is we'll have to do a vetting of documents or agreements. So investee clients will be sending the documents to the customer, to the investee. Investee will in turn will hire us and they will ask us to vet these documents. So again, when we are vetting the documents, we have to understand very importantly where is the jurisdiction in case of arbitration, where is the jurisdiction in case of litigation, is some of the critical component of vetting of documents. Second thing is how the vesting of shares will happen, how the consideration will flow into the company, how the investee is going to fund us, what is the valuation, all the critical areas will be there which we need to do the vetting of transactions. Third important area, which we all know that this was initially completely valuation services was with us. Now, after this new amendments which have happened in valuation rules from a Companies Act point of view, and also even separate valuation boards have been set up by Institute also, and various other IBB has been set up in this area. So valuation predominantly was one of the very important areas as a practice in FEMA, where I used to do a lot of valuations earlier, because this was completely with us as a chartered accountant. Normal chartered accountant could have done the valuation services. I think post implementation of this IBBA and other Companies Act amendment, as you know now, the valuation services has certain limitations unless we have done our valuation course. If we have done the valuation course, then I think we can do in the FEMA, we can do valuation under discounted method also, and also under the normal net asset value or any other method we can do. In FEMA, the word they use is internationally accepted method of valuation. They don't specify any particular method of valuation. So when we do that, now merchant banker has come into place for valuation services also. We can get the client can get the valuation done through a merchant banker, or it can be done through a chartered accountant. This is one of the area. If you have done the valuation services, valuation course, then definitely we can do valuation services. I think one of the interesting situation which has come after this valuation course being introduced and valuation board has come into place, and also a merchant banker come into place, that the average value of fees which we used to charge for valuation services has gone by at least 40%. So that means if you are charging at earlier at 1 lakh rupees, we can charge now at least 1 lakh 40, 1 lakh 50 thousand, because that the supply has come down from the supply has come down because valuation course is a requirement is there. Many chartered accountants might have yet to do, or many, you know, there are certain other merchant bankers themselves have increased the fees because they have got a new opportunity. So because of that reason, the valuation services is very, 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 very remunerative if we are able to come do the valuation course and then complete that process. So next one is, I think certifications is one of the another area. And we will come to each of these certifications, which are the certifications which we can do when we cover that in the four segments, what type of certifications will come into place and what is that we can get out of it in that area also. The last but not the least is the filings and reporting. This is also one of the area. It's like doing the job where we'll have to continuously monitor what filings has to be done, what reporting has to be done. The due dates has to be added because the RBI has set in a certain due dates. If there is no, if the non-compliance, then we have to pay late filing fees and things like that. So in view of that, filings and reporting, and also one of the important thing is filings and reporting is a continuous revenue earning generating area. If you have a set of clients, we can generate monthly. There are some of the areas where we can do a monthly filing and get some money, monthly earning. Yearly reportings are there. And also we have a time-based reportings based on the activity which happens. So these are all the broad areas which we generally able to visualize and also try to explore these areas from the client's perspective. Now let us go back to our earlier slide, where which are all the areas in foreign direct investments apart from consulting, what and all activity, which are all the areas which we can get where we can do a practice. When foreign direct investments, as you know, there are two types of filing which will require on an event based. First, event based is when a resident company gets funds from outside India, when resident company gets money from outside India and the money is received in India and we have to go for allotment of shares. So there are two things. One is when we receive in India, client would have given the declaration that why the money has come and FIRC will get generated. Once an FIRC get generated, you will have 60 days time. Under Companies Act, it is 60 days, but under FEMA, it is 180 days, where it says within 60 days, you need to allot shares. So when you go for allotment of shares, if the transfer is between a company, where the company is investing, we call it as a further allotment of shares. When there's a transfer of shares is from the company, where the further allotment of shares happens from a company to a non-resident investor, okay, we'll have to file the FC GPR, where we have to do FC GPR filing. Okay. When we do an FC GPR, now, as you know, that the SMF portal has come into place where master form is created in RBI portal, where there's a separate portal is there, and we need to create a master entity master and also the investee master and all this thing. That you might be already aware of that. I will not go into that. But when you have to file FCGPR, first is we have to do all the allotment procedures which is required under Companies Act. In that, what opportunity we have is we need to do a certification of FCGPR. We have to do a certification of FCGPR. And before that, if you have done a valuation, you can also do a valuation also. So valuation and FCGPR filing is one of the area under FDI where we can create an opportunities under FEMA. So where we can charge clients as and when every allotment when the money comes into place, it is an area of professional practice for us. You can look into that area. Another in the FDI only, there's another scenario which will come into places where generally, it is covered under FDI, but is technically it is when a non-resident investor sells his shares to a resident investor, that we call it as a transfer of share from non-resident to resident. In the earlier scenario, we call it as transfer of share from resident to non-resident. So that is where FCGPR will come into place. Second one is where a non-resident will transfer his shares to resident. We call it as that's a transfer of share from non-resident to resident. This is also part of the FDI, but under we call it as under foreign investment, where things like that, where a resident is selling shares to a non-resident. Non-resident is selling shares to a resident. In this case, FCGPR, instead of FCGPR, we call it as a FCTRS. An FCTRS form has to be filed. The procedure is same, where only certain regulations are different. Procedures is almost like same, where a resident investor or a resident buyer has to fulfill the filing obligations under FEMA. As you know, in FEMA, only resident is made obligatory to fulfill the filing requirements under FEMA or be a requirement. That means to say a non-resident will never be held responsible for non-filing, even though they may be party to the transaction, but they will never be made responsible for non-filing of returns or things like that, because the entire responsibility to comply under FEMA has been put to resident investor, resident Indian, or maybe resident, you can call it as. So whenever a resident either sells his shares or transfers his shares or buys the shares from non-resident, for this FCGPR and FCTRS is applicable where valuation rules are applicable and where the filing of FCTRS is applicable. So within 30 days from the allotment of shares or the buying of shares, a filing with RBI through the authorized dealer has to be made. So this is an area of opportunity where we can do a certification of FCGPR or FCTRS, and we can also do the valuation of shares. So this is under foreign direct investments. There are other small areas are there where we have to do some certifications and things like that. But predominantly under FDI, apart from what I explained about vetting of documents, vetting of preparation of agreements and all, this is an area of where we can do event-based. These are all event-based, as in when the funds hit into the bank account of the client, you have to comply these things. So comply these regulations. That's on the foreign direct investments. Second important area, which is not explored by small SMEs, generally explored by bigger companies and all, is the external commercial borrowings. So in this external commercial borrowings, what type of activity, what type of work we can do? Again, same type of activities which will be involved, except the valuation services. There is no valuations involved in external commercial borrowings because it's a transaction between a lender and the borrower. So the question is only about how to prepare an agreement in compliance with the external commercial borrowing regulations. We call it as masters. There is a master circular on external commercial borrowings, which will define the lending rate, how much is the maximum lending rate you can agree, what is the penalties that you can agree, what is the payment terms or the what is the in terms of the timelines you can agree, the minimum maturity period. Okay, there are minimum conditions has to be taken care of, like MAMP, we call it as minimum average maturity period, which has to be defined. It has to be in line with the regulations, ECB regulations. This MAMP, we say that 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, is all come into place. Earlier we had, for minimum 7 years were there for certain type of transactions, but now it is even 10 years have been defined under recent amendments which has happened. In the recent amendment, a lot of benefits have been provided under ECB, which you can go through it. This is one of the very, very interesting area where preparation of loan agreement, preparation of drawdown notice, preparation of repayment schedule, and then preparation of the filing of form ECB return, filing of form ECB. Earlier we call it as a form 83, where generally whenever a loan agreement has been entered into between two borrower and lender, so the RBI had asked us to file this loan agreement details in form 83 for obtaining the loan registration number. Okay, as you know that in RBI, before you go for a loan, you should have a loan registration number. We call it as a LRN. So before you actually borrow funds from outside India, LRN has to be obtained. So how do you obtain LRN? LRN can be received only after we file form ECB, which is newly, we call it as form ECB. Earlier it was form 83. So in that form 83, you will fill all the details, like who is the borrower, who is the lender, what is the arrangement between them, all the details will be filled in there. So apart from preparation of the loan agreement, will also can charge clients for preparation of form 83 or form ECB. So for obtaining LRN. So once you obtain a LRN, before you actually get LRN, this form 83 is again certified by a company secretary, or it has to be certified by a charter. So when you certify it, you are confirming to the RBI that You have verified the loan agreement details and you have verified all the compliances to the FEMA law and the agreements or the conditions which you have put in form 80 in the loan agreement, and also the terms which you have set in the form ECB is in compliance with the FEMA Act. This is what you will certify. In the summary sheet, there is something called a summary sheet which will also provide all the summary and which you certify this summary sheet. So when you certify it, you will definitely go through all the terms of the agreements, and also you will verify whether the loan agreement is in line with FEMA regulations and FEMA conditions or FEMA law, and then only you will certify it. Because the entire responsibility of compliance to this loan agreement or compliance to this Form 83 is discharged on you. That means you are responsible for it. Tomorrow we cannot say, or as a chartered accountant, we cannot say that it's more of a certification of facts, but you are also certifying that the conditions are in line with the FEMA Act. Okay. So this is an interesting, this is an area of practice. And once you get an LRN, so what happens? Once you get an LRN, you will get a funds. Once you get an LRN, along with a copy of LRN or along with the LRN number, you will be asking your lender to send money to India. So money will hit into India. Once the money hits into India, then the FIRC or the you will get the transaction advisory, remittance advisory detail. Based on that, what happens is every month from the date of every month from which you have received the funds from outside India, you have to file form ECB2 returns. This is form ECB2 returns is a monthly ECB return which you need to file. So this is an area of practice where if you have 4 or 5 monthly compliances, 4 or 5 ECB running every month, you can charge every month, you can file them, you can charge them on a monthly basis for every month you filing the return. So form monthly return, what and all it involves generally is that it will ask about whether you have received the funds in during this month, whatever conditions on which you have we have borrowed this fund, like you want to spend for capital expenditure, you want to fund for working capital requirement, or you want to fund for whatever reason you have specified in the loan agreement, you will, whether that spending has happened or not, whether there is any hedging has been done or not, whether there is any interest liability which is accruing to the outside India, whether that payment has happened within the due date set in the loan agreement, all the complaints to the loan agreement, you will be updating to the RBI on a monthly basis. This is what you generally certify. So that is the reason. It is not just about certifying a certificate or something. It is more than that. You are actually monitoring the loan agreement on behalf of RBI. So they believe that you are monitoring them, that the loan agreement which is set between the borrower and lender is monitored through you, and you are certifying it. So because of that reason, you can charge them on a monthly basis so that it will become an area of practice. So if you have 4 or 5 ACBs, which we generally, if you get at least 5 to 6 ACB, then it becomes a clearly monthly income for you, where you can this is like a till the period of ECB. Generally, ECB is more than 3 years only ECB will happen. So this will be for 3 years, 5 years, or it can be 10 years. For 10 years, you will have this monthly income, provided you agree with the client and a client agrees with you on this. So this is an area of interest for me also, because I've been working on ECBs because of these two reasons. One is an area of interest for me. Second one is this becomes a monthly income as we go along. Okay. So under ECB, this is the thing which will happen. Second is connected to this ECB, we have additional certifications will happen. For example, so whenever you have to make a payment outside India, interest especially, or maybe in any other, whether repayment of tranche. Suppose you agree every year you pay $10,000 as a loan repayment to outside India. So whenever you make payment of $10,000 plus interest of $1,000, your banker will not remit this fund unless there is a CA certification. So your banker will say, I need to get a Form 15 CA, 15 CB, and I need to get certifications for Form 15 CA, 15 CB. So this is also connected to that. This becomes an area of practice for you. So whenever there's a interest payments outside India, you will get an additional opportunity of making you know, professional income from FEMA. So that is why this ECB is something that you can always look at for your building your profile under practice. So one of the thing in ECBs also is that suppose you want to do some modifications, you want to do some amendments to the loan agreements, you want to do some amendments to the transactions which you are already agreed but you want to change it for a future. So we call it as an amendment. So whenever there's an amendment required, we'll have to again file Form 83. So when we go for filing Form 83, amended Form 83, again, this is another area of interest which you can. So this is the whole gist of things which will happen in the ECBs. So that you can become, so that it becomes your an area of practice. So we have generally covered now in terms of professional opportunities in external commercial borrowings. There is another interesting area is trade matters. Trade, actually, this trade related matters has connection to foreign trade policies, which I think Mr. Abhishek Sharmaji was supposed to take session. But I will also try to touch up what possible areas are going to be part of the foreign trade policy. But predominantly, we will be looking from export and imports and trade-related matters. This trade-related matters also governs matters relating to resident individuals, matter relating to current account transactions, like, for example, if you want to transfer funds from India to outside India for education purposes, you want to do for tours and all this. There are so many other areas which will come to this. So first area we'll look at is exports, which is generally, I think this is one of the, even though it's one of the very interesting and very big area for our practice, but somehow it has not been, generally the client, especially the MSMEs and the others, generally they hire a custom agent and route the every transaction through them and they get these things covered. But in my opinion, this is one of the very large areas which will be actually the bigger the SMEs should take advices so that they can get good advices, they can get a good control on what they are doing and how they are doing things like that. Export, as you know, the export is one of the interesting area where whenever there is a transaction happens, whenever there is an export of service or export of goods happens from India to outside India, generally when we do a service through port or when we do a goods export, this will be documented through a customs department. It will be documented through postal. If you send through post, there's a custom which will document. If you send by airline, it will be documented through customs. If you send by send by sea, that means through port, it is documented. So whenever any export happens, these export are documented in the customs department portal. And also earlier, there was a lot of gap between banks and custom department. Now on a phase-wise basis, they are already integrating the customs department, the banking department. So there are a lot of advisory is required in the areas of export. For example, let us start with an example. When A sends goods outside India, he will initially enter into an agreement that we will send 1 million worth of goods and you have to pay me happen within 30 days of reaching this goods outside India. So the exporter will export and the goods are received in the port as per the agreed delivery terms. And once it is received, there will be either there will be LC or there will be this one. That areas are different. Whenever there is a LC, what happens is they will submit the document and within 30 days, this will get cleared. So those areas, generally, we do not have any challenges in exports because it is, certain challenges are there, which will come to that. But when within 30 days of reaching, if the money is supposed to reach India and it does not reach India, so there is a delay in realization of exports. Whenever there's a delay in realization of exports, generally within 6 months, up to 6 months, there's no there is no need, up to 6 months the time is given under FEMA, where within 6 months you need to realize. So where there is a certain delay for certain reasons, up to 9 months authorized dealer can provide you the benefit of realizing the exports outside India, up to 9 months, or it can go up to 12 months. Beyond 12 months, we need to apply to the RBI. Many of the trade related matters get stuck here only. You will see that customs, there is an entry in the bank. There is a bank is also been dumped with so many. Bank has been nowadays, the bank has been dumped with that export data, electronic data processing. There is one integration which has happened where the custom department will dump to bank, dump to the all the exports which has done in the earlier years, and they have dumped it to the bankers, and bankers are sending emails and letters saying that these against these exports, company has not received the realizations against these export invoices. This is the area which has created lot of friction between the bank authorized dealer and the exporter. This has resulted in a lot of non-compliances, and even RBIs are issuing notices to clarify why these realizations have not happened within the time. So what has went wrong in this? There could be many issues which would have gone wrong in this area. That's where our role come into place. Our role come into place where we can do a transaction advisory or the export advisory services. What do you mean by export advisory services? One is there are a lot of benefits which have been provided under exports, especially when you do with FEMA and it is linked with foreign trade policy. That means to say, if you are not realizing a particular export, or if the authorized dealer is not confirming that this has received in time, because of whatever reason, then you may not be able to get the export benefits. Because whatever exports you have realized, only on realized exports, you get the foreign trade policy benefits. So from that point of view, the lot of SMEs are getting stuck in this area because of, it could be mistake with the authorized dealer, it could be mistake with the exporter, or it could be that a wrong advice has been given, or no advices have been taken from the chartered accountant or expert. So this is an area where we can understand what FEMA regulations talks about, how the export documentation should happen, and how the authorized dealer, how the list of pending invoices should be from authorized dealer on regular basis, so that your books and the authorized dealer books are on par with regard to realization of dues is concerned, and so that there is a clarity between what you have received as per your books and what is as per the authorized dealer. So in that sense, it is very important. So which are all the areas which we can add value to the MSMEs? One is, what is the actual position under FEMA, and what is the actual position under foreign trade policy? The actual position is whether we can get any benefits when we receive realizations more than 12 months. Do we get the export benefits under that, or do we get the foreign trade policy benefits where we have this MEIS scheme and SEIS scheme and all these things where we get the export benefits on the export of the data? All these things we can explain to the customer, to the MSMEs, so that they understand this and then complete that. In this, one of the thing is sometime the export documentation or export documentation needs to be certified. So that is also where, as you know, I think whenever you will under foreign trade policy, especially again connected to FEMA, whenever any duty drawbacks has to be claimed, or whenever duty entitlement has to be claimed with the foreign trade policy or the DGFT, or with the foreign trade department like DGFT, where they will ask you to certify the what is the value of exports, FOB value of the exports which is conducted by the which is exports conduct, what is exports done, and also realizations also you will have to certify it. So this is so certifications is one of the area, as you know, that in the exports, and also very important is on the regular consulting which can be done in trade related matters. In export also, there are certain things where whether when I'm doing an export, whether I can open an EFC account, whether I can open a FCNR account, whether I can open a foreign RFC account, or all these things. So how do you guide which is the better account to open for exporter and the importer? So this is again comes under FEMA regulations, where whenever a customer wants to open an account for relating to foreign transactions, there is a specific area where you can go and check domestic where accounts, foreign currency accounts to be opened in India on behalf of the exporters. This is another area of advisory, where keeping the method of transaction, keeping the method of export, keeping the other transaction which the MSMEs do, especially if they have a lot of exports and imports. Generally, EFC account is a very, very important account where the exporters have to open, so that they have a lot of saving on the foreign currency fluctuations. They have a lot of saving on the foreign currency conversion charges and bank charges. So likewise, each business has certain, like, dollar account, which is specifically applicable for gem sector, gold, gems, and the bullion sector, where all these things, where there are certain specific accounts which are there, which is being devised to benefit the exporters and also importers. So on the trade related matters, we can do a lot of advisory to the exporters and also to importers, where they can save a lot of money on conversion, a lot of money on claiming benefits, duty entitlements, and all these things. So that is why exports is one of the important area which will help us. In this export also, the question will come into place. There are so many questions which can come into place in exports. One of the important question is whether a credit card transactions, when I sell outside India, I receive money from outside India through a credit card account, whether that becomes my export realization, whether it becomes my foreign currency transaction, whether I can complete these things, whether I get a benefit under DGFT. These are all the areas of interest where you can guide clients. There are a lot of transactions which happens on e-commerce outside India, whether those are all governed under exports, whether you can get any benefit under GST. All these are all the matters, whether my realization in rupees by foreign. There are so many scenarios we have heard, for example, where because of some problem, like what happens is the outside India party, we will send money from outside India in Indian rupees. Whether that will amount to an export under FEMA, or whether it will amount to export under foreign trade policy, whether that will be helpful for us to claim the export benefits or not. So these are all the questions can be answered. These are all the areas which we can add value to them. For example, there are another scenario where third party exports will happen, where third party exports are also governed under foreign trade policy. Okay, but not governed under FEMA. But if there is a sale which happens from third party to an exporter, and the money is received from in Indian rupees, whether that can be covered under foreign trade policy. These are all the areas which are there. Definitely, we can add a lot of value in the area of exports and imports. There are a lot of questions can come into place where we can address to them, and things like that. So the exports is one of the interesting area from my point of view. And there are important things which as a consultant, which we should keep in place, which keep in our mind, is if the exports are not realized within 1 year, then we might have to go with the through RBI, through authorized dealer, we have to seek additional time to RBI for allowing us to realize for more than 12 months, and we have to specify the reason and things like that. Another interesting area is when you are writing off any balances relating to exports, you have to seek approval from RBI. This is all important things which the MSMEs or MSEs will not know. They will just write off in their books of account. And we as a statutory auditors also sometimes we just certify that everything is good and things like that. But it is not correct. Whenever there's an export write-off happens, there is a very clear guidance are there. There is a master regulation on export and export or import of goods and services, which is there is a master regulation, and we have to keep that in mind. So when we understand this, we can guide them, and this is an area of consulting which can happen. Now, in the trade related matters, I think there's a under trade related matters. Just a minute, just we can. Mr. Kore, Koreji, this is audible. This is okay. We are good to go.
Yes, sir. It is audible.
Okay. On the trade-related matters, imports is another very important area where we can add value to the clients. So in imports, what happens is there are generally three type of activity will happen. One is the apart from what is governed under external commercial borrowing, external commercial borrowings also in this import area. In the import, what happens is within you have to pay out based on your agreement. Generally, if within 12 months the import bill has to be remitted outside India. If it is more than 12 months, we generally we have it called, we call it 6 months. 6 months to 12 months is generally extended up through the authorized dealer. So more than 12 months, we call it as a trade credit or supplier credits. Okay. So this trade credit is and supplier credit is up to 3 years. So that means to say, generally you might have noticed that many many Indian companies, they import machines, capital goods, or they import machines, and they enter into them with them, they enter into a trade credit arrangement or the supplier credit arrangement with the supplier credit arrangement with the supplier itself. So whenever they have an arrangement within for a trade credits and also supplier credits, this is also part of the import transactions. So in the trade regulation, there is a clear cut regulations are there, how much rate of interest you can agree, what is the period up to which trade credits can be availed, what is the period up to which supplier credit can be availed. And this is the area which we have seen many of cases where there's a transaction between subsidiary and parent. Many of the times there are non-compliances in these areas. That means to say they take trade credits without any communication to authorized dealer, and the trade credits are availed for more than 3 years, and the payment terms have set up in such a way that they have scheduled it for more than 3 years, or the rate of interest scheduled in such a way that is beyond the permissible limit permitted by the FEMA. So these are all the non-compliances which we generally see in the import areas. Okay. In this import area, whenever any trade credits or whenever there is any supplier credit which goes beyond 3 years, it will be termed as external commercial borrowings. That means to say, whenever any import machinery you import and you are payment obligations are going beyond 3 years, that means to say you need to apply a external commercial borrowing. You cannot go through a general import payment methodology, or you cannot general go through trade credit methodology and things like that. So whenever there is a obligation which falls beyond 3 years, you have to seek a LRN, and then you have to go for the further approval. So in that segment, non-compliances can be there. So this is an interesting area where you can engage with your clients who do a lot of import and export activities, where they undertake a lot of works. They do a lot of imports for the export, or they do a lot of import of machinery for the purpose of expansion in India. In those, or they borrow funds from outside India to fund the imports. These are all the areas which you can, a lot of value can be added. So when any customer is having or any borrower is having a lot of import or export, we generally recommend them to open a EFC account. Why it is EFC? Because EFC account up to 30 days, your export realizations can be, with your export realization up to 30 days, this can be, without converting into Indian rupees, this funds can be available in foreign currency in EFC account. That means to say, from the date of realization till 30 days, you can keep these funds in foreign currency so that you can meet your import payable requirements. Generally, what happens is when any funds hits to our account, it will get converted immediately so that the funds are available in Indian rupees. But what happens is, suppose you have to make a payment outside India, what will happen is you have to pay in again in dollar terms. There will be conversion, there will be charges, there will be a lot of other charges will be applicable when, and there is a lot of loss due to foreign currency fluctuation. So because of that, you can definitely look into the method of different type of accounts which you can open with the banker, and then use those accounts for the benefit of the companies. So when you look into these areas, you will also advise clients, and this can be an interesting area of consultation for you. So next one is in the same trade related matters. Generally, we call it as not trade related matters, just for your info, but there are certain other activities which will happen. Like, for example, suppose you are a person wants to send money outside India. Okay, he has sold his property in India. He has sold his property. He's a resident in India, and he sold a property in India, and he wants to send this money outside India by gift outside India to his son or to his daughter or to anyone. So again, whenever there is a fund transfer from India, there is a certification which is required from FEMA, from a banker, which they will ask you to certify whether these limits, whether the LRS compliances are there or not. So under LRS, if the amount is below 250,000, any banker will ask you to remit, and banker will remit, and the things like that. But now what happens is, if you have to transfer more than 250,000, so what can be done? Whether I cannot transfer at all, or what are the options that we have? This is the area which you can generally get into you can help the customers, or you can help the assessees in this area. So generally, whenever there is a requirement where you have to remit something beyond the LRS amount, then you have to go to authorized dealer. From authorized dealer, you have to go to RBI, seek a specific approval from RBI, and then get the approval from them, and then we can make payment outside. But as you know, that getting approval from RBI is not easy, and it is completely on the discretionary basis and things like that. But this is also one of the area of practice for us, where you can liaison between authorized dealer, RBI, and the client who wants to take your help in getting specific approvals on matters which are not generally allowed by RBI. Okay. So which are all other areas which we can generally get help on trade related matters, on other matters, is that also probably this we can cover it under foreign direct investment also, is that whenever a foreign entity wants to set up an entity in India, as you know, there are four types of entity can be set up in India. One is either you open a branch, you open a liaison office, or you open a project office. Apart from that, you can open a private limited company. Anyway, as we know, that we call it as a FDI. So generally, this branch, liaison office, and project office, we don't call it as an FDI, because it is just a foreign entity which is getting incorporated in India. So that is the thing. So whenever somebody wants to set up an entity in India, so they can go through these three methods: branch, liaison office, and project office. So to seek a specific approval from RBI, so there is a liaisoning or documentation or application filing, and all thing is required, where we can play a vital role in getting a entity registered in India. So in this, you can liaison with the liaison with the companies outside India, collect all the documentation, liaison with them, and get the specific approval, and also incorporate that with Companies Act under foreign entity, and then take up the matter for regular filing and other things. So there are a lot of conditions and regulations are applicable for each of these areas. So you must, one should know that what all specific regulations are applicable for branch office, under which circumstances you have to create a branch office, under which circumstances you have to create a liaison office, what activities permitted under liaison office, what activities permitted under project office, how the funding will happen to these funds, whether the tax has to be paid. There are so many things for a come into place. When any branch is created in India, a statutory audit should happen, and a statutory auditor has to certify. And there are this creates ample opportunities for you to on a regular basis where we can definitely make a good practice when we have an entity which is created as a branch or liaison office, things like that. There are a lot of ongoing activities will happen where we will do an audit, filing of audit will happen. After that, we will have to, whenever there is a surrender of branch certificate, you will have to file the you have to submit the certificate to RBI that all closure formalities are completed, and all the export all the proceeds before it is remitted back to outside India, you will certify that after paying all the due taxes to Indian government, only the surplus funds have been repatriated back outside India. So these are all the areas which you can look into it. Repatriation is one of the interesting area where whenever repatriation happens from India to outside India, our certifications are required. So this is also one of the area which you can practice. One more, another area is on the trade related matter is that relating to non-resident. What happens when any funds are transferred from a non-resident Indian to his account outside India? What are the regulations are applicable? There are a lot of advisories will come whether the non-resident who is transferring from outside India, whether any FEMA is involved and things like that. Okay. So generally FEMA is applicable between any transaction between resident and non-resident outside India. But in this case, since the funds are getting transferred from non-resident account, from Indian entity, from Indian thing to outside India, generally even banker generally, if it is large amount of money, they seek a certificate from a chartered accountant saying that the funds which are transferring outside India is after paying all due taxes and things like that. And even under FEMA, for an advisory to show that they comply with the FEMA, even on FEMA, generally what happens is up to $1 million, non-resident Indian can transfer funds from India to outside India without any issues being, without any non-compliances under FEMA. That means to say, under LRS, we have only 250,000 for resident. Under, for non-resident, he has up to $1 million he can transfer outside India. So very important thing, or we advise about transfer of fund from India to outside India for a non-resident category and all, we should ensure that in all circumstances, he is clearly a non-resident. That means to say he is staying outside India for more than 82 days, or he has gone outside India to set up business permanently outside India. And so there are a couple of conditions which is applicable under Section 6 or Section 2 and Section 6, where Section 2 especially, where the definition talks about under which circumstances a person can become a non-resident. Okay. So we have to ensure that whenever we do an advice, so we need to go back to our definitions and understand that we are advising properly to the customers on this. So that is an area. There are so many other things might be small areas will be there under each of these exports and imports. Apart from what I explained, there could be small minor areas where certifications are required, or export obligation certifications, or maybe import the utilization certificate. Generally what happens is whenever the external commercial borrowings have come into place, the we have to certify the utilization and things like that. Sometimes the borrower will ask you to certify by the statutory auditor that whether all the ACB conditions have been fulfilled, whether the money sent has been utilized for the said purpose, and things like that, whether the RBI compliances have taken care. So these are all the certificates which generally will be sought by the lender, or it can be sought by RBI, or it can be sought by authorized dealer, or it can be sought by any agency in India in this area. So this is a very vast area where we can definitely make lot of inroads into the practice and things like that. So, and this is also an area where generally if client will ask you to give you free advices also, because for them it looks like this is a very easy area, and all of us, we have handy information and things like that. But at the same time, we have to also look into the commercial aspects. they respect your opinions, they respect our opinions, they respect our you know, time which we spend in earning this knowledge or gaining this knowledge. So this is about export and imports, and I would also like to go to the next one, which is about overseas direct investment. As you know, this is a complete opposite to foreign direct investments, and this is, I have seen wherever I have able to interact with clients, I have seen this is the most non-compliance happens in this area. I think off late, because of the late filing fees, because of the certain penalty being provided by the RBI off late, this has been now getting complied. But wherever I have seen, this is a you know, many clients or many SSEs, SMEs, they generally you know, is non-compliance under this area. They believe that whatever funds they transfer from India to outside India to run a branch or to run a subsidiary outside India, they just don't need to comply anything. They just have to, you know, just transfer funds and then account for it as an investment. No, that is not correct. So in view of that's why I think this is an area of practice. This is an area of consulting, like how we have an FDI, there is something called ODI. What is ODI? This is overseas direct investments. So what are the roles that we can play apart from what we have already explained to you about forming an agreement and you know, transaction advisory and all this thing? So one is, we need to understand when ODI is applicable, which are all transactions ODIs are applicable. We need to advise the clients very clearly that what type of transaction can amount to ODIs and things like that. There are predominantly two, three types of transactions which generally happen and which is supposed to be classified as ODI. One is investment in subsidiaries, investment in joint ventures, investment in associates. This is one area which is covered under overseas direct investment. Second area is loan to subsidiaries. Loan to subsidiaries outside India, loan to associates, loan to joint ventures. Third one is advances, long-term advances provided to subsidiaries and things like that. These are the three generally areas which are generally, which will be covered under overseas direct investment. All the procedures which are required to file, ODI has to be fulfilled. Now this, one of the thing is, whenever ODI is to be done, okay, first we need to apply to through AD. We need to submit the ODI form. We have to submit the ODI form to the RBI and we have to get the approval from them. And after that, we have to do the ODI investment in it. There are certain automatic approvals are also put in place, where automatic approvals are there. There are certain procedures have been put in place where automatic approval can be obtained. So one of the critical component of ODI is that, they have set in the cap of investment outside India up to 400% of your net worth. Okay, up to 400% of your net worth, only you can do ODI outside India. So more than 400%, you need to obtain a specific approval from RBI. Up to 400%, you can go and do a ODI and do a automatic approval through automatic approval, where you have to making after a ODI, you have to immediately report to. You have to immediately report through AD to RBI. So all the procedures relating to the ODI has to be performed. For example, that once you make an ODI, you have to report to to RBI. After that, before ODI is done, the shares valuation of shares is already done outside India, and the valuation rules are complied as per ODI rules, and all this, and share certificates are sent to India within six months of funds being transferred. There are certain terms and conditions have been set in place. So in view of that, ODI becomes an area of interest where you have to certify again ODI forms to be certified, and we have to do the similarly opposite procedures what we do for FDI. So in view of that, this is again another area of interest where we can do the practice. Generally, valuation of shares has to be done by, we can shares from here also, or a valuation of done by a consultant which is approved by the local regulations. That means, for example, we set an entity in Dubai And there is a Dubai regulation which clearly says that share transfers has to be valued in a particular way by a local consultant, and they are authorized to do the valuation of shares for those entities, and you can get the valuation done from those consultants or from those experts also. Either it can be done by Indian chartered accountants or merchant bankers, or it can be done by experts who are sitting outside India. But in any case, whenever any investment happens, the share, the value of investment or the share at which you buy should not be more than the valuation derived by the consultant. That means if the value of share is set at 100 rupees, you cannot invest at 110 rupees or 101 rupee. Similarly, in ODI also, as FDI also, as you know, if the valuation is done at 100 rupees, you cannot allot shares at less than 100 rupees. So this is the opposite conditions which are there. So these important elements has to be kept in place whenever we do any practice in this area. And this is an area where you can ODI, you can continuously monitor, you can continuously, as a statutory auditor also, you have to report. As a statutory auditor also, you have to, it is an obligation for us to report whether all the family, whether all the FEMA guidelines have been complied for all the investments made outside India. And also for all trade related matters and external commercial borrowings and all for FDIs, statutory auditor has to comply or to certify or to express his opinion whether all the regulations applicable to MSMEs or the borrowers or the, you know, investees are fulfilled by the company. So this is again an area of interest which everybody can look into, that identify various possible opportunities in these areas and things like that. Now, apart from this, there is one more, there's one more. Under filings and reporting, there's one, I think everyone will be knowing this very, but I just want to highlight it. Whenever a year end happens, so the RBI will, before 31st of July, all companies which are having either FDI, either ECB, either ODI, okay, all companies which are having any of these elements in their balance sheet, they have to mandatorily file FLA return. What is this FLA return? Foreign assets and liabilities return. We call it as a FLA return. Earlier we used to file it through the Excel mechanism through by email. Now they have been merged with, it is now SMF, RBA portal is there where we can go and file all this. Automatically we can file all these things on the online portal, on the online mechanism. So in this FLA return, very importantly, it will ask about what FDIs you have, what ECBs you have, what FCCBs you have, how much FIIs are there, all the relevant details relating to your activity, which covers under FEMA, will be sought by the RBI in this area. Because this is an area which RBI wants to consolidate all the transactions in one return. So they have made this FLA return. So we have seen off late that many companies will delay in filing, or they don't file it, and they feel that many of them are not aware that this has to be filed. So that's where our role come into place. We can keep advising them that this annually we have to file. So this is an area which we can always charge to the clients, and we can file the returns. So this is another interesting area which can be. So apart from that, I think when we are doing transaction advisory services and all, there's a due diligence element will come into place. The due diligence generally will be done by the investee point of view, where investee will check whether you are complying with all the regulations, whether you have filed all the regulations or not. They will ask you to certify whether all the regulations have been fulfilled or not. Whether the compliance which is set in the conditions which is set in each of the agreement, whether it is fulfilled or not, all these areas are generally being asked to check, and due diligence will be done. And whenever a big investment happens, definitely there will be investment, definitely there will be due diligence in this area. I think there's one question from Mr. Devdas R, where if FLA return of earlier years not filed, what will be the consequences and whether it can be filed now? Kindly clarify. Yes, definitely. Consequences is nothing but I think earlier there was no penalty provisions was implement was been put in place earlier. So what used to happen is whenever there was a delay in filing any of this thing, there could be delay in filing of FLA return, delay in filing of FCGPR, delay in filing of any aspect, there was no fixed penalty was put in place. But now they have started defining each of the penalty areas and there are late filing fees. So we call it as for generally they say late filing fees up to 30 days. They have put the days. So they have put the late filing fees, I think up to 30 days is 5,000, 30 days to a particular period is 50,000 and it is just going on. So generally late filing fees is applicable. Earlier we were supposed to go for compounding of delays has to be filed by paying 5,000 to RBI. We should have gone for a compounding, but now we can the authorized dealer themselves will ask you to pay that 5,000, 50,000, whatever is applicable, and then you can regularize it by paying the penalties. That is point number one. Second is for FLA return is not routed through authorized dealer. That is why what happens is through your portal, generally you can file now, even if it is delay, you can file it. For earlier also it can be filed. Okay. But only concern is in the earlier years, especially I think we need to check in SMF, this portal, RBI firms portal, in the RBI firms portal, whether they allow us to file for the earlier period. Otherwise, if it is not allowable in the manual, in the firm's portal, then we have to file it through manually where we have the FLA at rba.org.in. By that email ID, you can file the Excel, which was earlier part of that. So when we do that Excel filing, if there is any non-compliance, definitely they'll come back to you and then you can regularize. Hope this is this addresses your query on the FLA of earlier years. I think on the FEMA part again, apart from this, there will be last part which generally I wanted to cover is that special adjudications and appeals. This is an area which is generally you can represent. One is that earlier we had this very detailed area of compounding of offenses was another area where we used to go and represent on behalf of the customer. On behalf of the client before the RBI and request them to compound, where compounding was allowed through an authorized representative, where either company secretary can represent or chartered accountant can represent or an advocate can represent. Any of these three people can represent before RBI, or it is also can be represented before special director appeals, where section 17 of FEMA allows us to make an appeal against any particular provision or against any particular order which is passed by RBI or any other authority. So under special director, either chartered accountant can also represent. You can represent for compounding also you can represent, and also for appeal matters also you can represent. Generally the areas like now predominantly most of the areas are coming under compounding. Like for example, delay in filing and all these things, these are all areas are already covered under compounding. There are certain areas like money laundering, non-compliances to FDI, that you have received the money in India and used it without allotting shares. There are certain areas which are does not cover under compounding, which we still have to go through the does not cover under this late filing fees and other things where the late filing fees applicable. You have to go through the compounding of offenses mechanism where you have to pay 5,000 rupees and apply for compounding, define your non-compliance on your own, and where the documentation will be provided, asked by you, by the RBI. Based on the merit of the case, they will levy you with penalty. Okay, it can be any amount. Depending on the non-compliances, RBI will levy the penalties and things like that. If you go to websites, they generally keep publishing about recent compounding of offenses, where you will come to understand what type of offenses are to be compounded, what type of offenses are generally levied penalty, what is the size of the penalty is levied. All these all can be learnt and then advised to the clients accordingly. So this is the gist of things which we can look into it. There are definitely, you know, a lot more things can be done with DTA connected to FEMA and all other things. It can be, you know, more elaborately can be done. But from a opportunity point of view, to just to summarize the opportunity point of view, I think this is the areas which we can definitely look to it and then enhance our knowledge in these areas. As you know, this is very dynamic in nature. Since it's being dynamic in nature, it becomes very important for us to keep updating ourselves and also being aware of all these matters. So with this, I think I know I've ended early, 1.5 hours, because you know, if we can take this can be summarized. If we have to go each area, then it becomes each one be one session. But since it's a summary of the opportunities under FEMA, I would you know, keep the remaining session for the question and answers. It can be through voice questions or it can be through, you know, chat box, whichever way. I would be happy to answer. Thank you.
Yeah, Santosh, it is only chat mode only, no voice mode, because more than 300, around 400 members are there.
Okay.
So it is very difficult task for the branch. I think you have taken some of the questions. So have you taken in the chat box or in question answer box?
I think only one question. I think one question I just answered on the FLA. I think on okay. The other question answer, I think I just have
to... Yeah, question I will take it here is there. Is FDA allowed in a trust and LLPs?
Trust it is not allowed. It is allowed in LLPs under specific permission approval. Automatic approval, as of now, it is not allowed.
What is the difference between EFC account and resident foreign currency account?
EFC account is generally opened by it is a business account, basically. That means you should be a importer or an exporter of goods. Only under that circumstances you can open an EFC account. Okay. And in RFC account, you can see this is a generally, it is like a RFC is nothing but a resident foreign currency account. Okay. Where you can, once a money is hit into that within the next 24 hours, within 24 hours, you need to convert that funds into immediately into Indian rupees. So in EFC account, what happens is you can keep the 30 days time. So that means up to 30 days, this foreign currency will be available in EFC account, and that can be used for making remittance outside India, where you can save on the the foreign currency fluctuation cost. That is the main reason EFC accounts, where you have multiple transactions, where you have multiple import export transaction, EFC accounts will be generally open.
Okay, members, if you have any questions, kindly put it in the question answer box, not in chat box. Okay, is valuation certificate mandatory in case of rights issue and equity is issued to existing non-resident shareholders under right issues?
Yes. See, valuation rules, as per what happens is, whenever any new allotment is made, either under preferential allotment or under rights issue, we need to have a valuation done at every point in. Suppose, for example, you have done 1 month back, you have done a allotment of share, and now again in next 1 month you are allotting the shares. In that circumstances, you can rely on the earlier valuation. Generally, up to 6 months period, you can use that same valuation. But if the valuation is more than 6 months, and if the business is very dynamic, and if the business is too much changing, the 6 months period you had a different projections, and now 6 months you have a different projection, in those circumstances it is not advisable to use the same valuation. But generally you can use up to 6 months period. You can, if the same valuation is used, if the same share price is adopted, then you can use the same valuation for last 6 months.
What is the procedure to be followed by third party exporter to claim MEIS benefit?
I think this is covered under FTP, but I'm not an expert, but I have some limited knowledge in this. I can explain to that. See, whenever there is a third party export happens, there is a MEIS scheme is already detailedly, FTP is already detailedly mentioned, that how a third party exports benefits can be claimed under foreign trade policy. One is all the documentation which the final exporter has done should specify that the third party exporter details should be there, where the goods have originated, who has manufactured it, and it is supposed to, they have to, all the, in the, all the export documents, this third party exporter details will be there. And in an, and even in an invoice, they have to say this is a, on the basis of third party exporter, this invoices will be done. Based on that, the question is, under foreign trade policy, the foreign currency realization should happen in India. That's a condition has been put in place. But under third party export, they also say that under third party exports, they also say that if the for even when if the third party manufacturer receives the money in even in Indian rupees, even he can claim the benefits under MEIS scheme. So, but you have to follow the other regulations which are applicable under specified under handbook of procedures under a foreign trade policy.
What are the reporting requirements for trade credit? At what point of time do we have to apply for ECB when trade credit period gets extended beyond 3 years?
One is, I think, first is, whenever any trade credits are availed, we need to report it to the, we need to inform to the authorized dealers. See, trade credit, we generally, what happens is, there are two circumstances where trade credit will happen. Where first trade credit is where I import and I do not have an intention to take a trade credit from him, but due to subsequently I understand that I have a problem in funding, that I am unable to get a support local funding. So what I'll do is I'll seek the credit time period from the lender or the supplier, and he will say that he will enter into an agreement with you and he will specify that. Based on that, if the maturity period is up to 36 months, that is up to 36 months, you don't need to go for the ECB. But if it is below 36 months, you need to report to the AD that you have availed a trade credit. Whenever that agreement is entered, or whenever there is, at the time of import through trade credit, if you have done, that time you have to, you know, the authorized dealer will come to know. And also at the time of, if subsequently you decide to convert a normal transaction into trade credit, you need to intimate to the authorized dealer that you have availed the trade against this.
What is status of violences in Vera now? If inheritance in 1981 here has not been reported, if I sell inherited property, what is the penalty?
You mean to, 1 minute. This year,
I think it is a 1981. They maybe have, they sell the property, inherited property, and they have not reported. So now asking the penalty.
Actually, first thing, if I understand facts right, you are trying to say that you have sold, you have got a, through inheritance, you got a property in 1981. And now you are selling, correct? Is that the question?
Yeah, the question, I will read it. What is the status of violations in FERA now?
Okay.
If inheritance in 1981 has not been reported.
See, first is, I think the law of limitation is already passed. I think I don't see any... see, one is FERA has been repealed. So there is no question of... FERA has been repealed. So there is no question of invoking any provisions applicable under FERA. That is point number one. So the point number two is whether the inheritance which I have received in 1981, which was not reported, first of all, because the FEMA was not there during that period, under FEMA, there is no need to report any inheritance to under FEMA or either under FERA, in my opinion. FERA may be there, but I am not exposed to that. But under FEMA, any inheritance which happens through even in the current period or in the earlier period, we don't need to report anything under FEMA. So the question of violation does not happen at the time of inheritance. The question is only when you sell the property and you transfer from outside India, you have to comply to that under LRS or remittance outside India or anything like that. Only under those circumstances, FEMA will come into place. Earlier issues is not an issue from my opinion.
ODI is incorrectly shown as service fee payment with incorrect code. So ODI compliance should not be made. What is the solution by an NRI?
One is I feel this is not covered by any penalty provision. So we need to go to the RBI for compounding of offense. we need to file an application before RBI, file a compounding, and based on their direction, this can be rectified or this can be condoned actually. Basically, we have to apply for a condonation.
Okay. That is the question, Santosh. It was an excellent presentation. I could say night watchman came and made a century. I can say it.
Thank you.
You exactly addressed nearly about 100 minutes. Very good, Santosh, for accepting our invitation. Because always when it is a difficulty come, then you will realize who can help us. So you timely help the, because I have not contacted, I contacted the first person itself is accepted. That was the greatest things, members from Santosh. Because always in Bangalore, one thing is that any speaker, if you contacted, definitely they will ready to serve for the branch. That was the what you can IPR, intellectual property we have in Bangalore branch. That was a great asset for always a resource persons. Those who are, I wish for their speed growth for to become as an international speaker. So Santosh has covered the most of the topic, and he is expert in that ECB, external commercial borrowing. And what we thought is to give more opportunities. What are the opportunities for the members apart from our regular? So we wanted to do it some trial and error base. We wanted to attempt for the, let's our younger members and the members who wanted to look into the other dry areas where most of the chartered account will not practice. Only if you have any queries, you normally used to contact Santosh and other our friends. So that is what our motto. And today's foreign trade policy and other scheme topic will be handled in some other days with the, what are the opportunities available. So on behalf of all the viewers and managing committee members of Bangalore branch, bottom of my heart, thank Santosh for his excellent presentation on professional opportunities under FEMA. Thank you, Santosh.
Thank you so much. And I must thank. I must thank Bangalore branch for this opportunity.
Santosh and members, tomorrow we are having session on how to grow your practice digitally using social media. It's been covered by Sanjeev Sangvi from Kolkata. And 28th October, we are having an important session from Dheeraj K. Sharma and our SRC chairman, Dungachan Jain, is going to address. It is a session on code of ethics, because all members, we need to compulsorily have the session on code of ethics, because we have already conducted two sessions. But again, based on members' request, we have planned on 28th October. Hope we are wish our tax date will get extended, because recently our one of the Central Council member has visited our Bangalore branch. And he also informed that definitely tax date hope it will get extended, because it is everything is pressure now. Corona, after corona, corona, all economy is going on. All clients just showing the hand finger to chartered accountants and simply aram say they are doing the business. Now we have to, as a chartered accountant, we have to manage our clients, cash flow, office, yes, all difficulties we need to face it. Yes, our friends are only a little bit effort from the Bangalore branch to make it them in active force for the, through Dhyana Dasova. Hope the things will set right soon. With that note, I thank Santosh and all the viewers for the participating, nearly 400 viewers for the today's session. I request Bank Treasurer C.A. Divya to render the formal vote of thanks to the today's speaker and all the viewers. Over to Divya.
Thank you, Chairman. I would like to take this opportunity on behalf of Bangalore branch committee members to render a formal vote of thanks for today's webinar. First of all, thanks a lot to Santosh sir for giving your excellent presentation along with in such a short notice of time, sir. Thanks a lot, sir, once again from all the viewers.
Pleasure. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, sir. I also thank all the participants for your patience hearing and also wonderful cooperation throughout our all the webinars. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
Thank you.